Hello everyone, welcome to Cheer Challenge. On this channel, I try new and fun things in a form of challenges. This time, I just started a years-long challenge. I became a PhD student in public health in Karolinska Institutet last week. In this video, I'll share an overview of becoming a PhD student in Sweden, taking Karolinska as an example. I'll talk about how is a PhD paid, how long is a PhD, how is the position established, where to find information, eligibility, and so on. Let's dive right in. How to support myself is the first concern if I were to start studying again. Depending on the country, it is common to pay to do a PhD. Applying to a scholarship can be necessary but complicated. However, in Sweden, PhD is a job. Yes, you heard me right. It is considered an employment. So, is it paid? Absolutely. In addition, the payment will rise across the years. A full-time PhD is generally 4 years, and the mean salary will be close to $3,000 per month. In Sweden, the employee usually have a meeting with the employer to discuss the salary. For PhD students, however, there is a board of representatives who discuss the salary collectively for all PhD students in a given university. So there's a fixed salary for PhD students in each university, and you can easily figure out how much it is on the website. PhD students are of course also students with student discounts and especially student housing help. This salary can give a comfortable life in my opinion. Let's move on to how a PhD position is created and where to find information. The goal of PhD program is to raise a good researcher, so first there needs to be a research project and this project needs to be feasible within the 4 year time range and will have the possibility to reach many educational goals. A research proposal of usually 4 planned studies is to be submitted to the doctoral board to assess the feasibility and relevance. Of course, this project should have obtained ethical approval or undergoing application. The main supervisor will shoulder no less than 70% of the responsibility to guide the student through the 4 years. Therefore, he or she needs to be judged on the ability to supervise, which is what this green light is all about. To obtain the green light, the supervisor would need to have gone through supervising training, have enough academic competence, not have had serious conflicts with past PhDs, and have enough time to supervise. Which means that he or she do not have too many students, projects, or other responsibilities. The co-supervisors will share the rest of the responsibility. How they can help the student and the project needs to be justified so that a good group of competence can be formed to support the students from different perspectives. Finally, the financial plan, which is the hardest part of establishing a PhD. To ensure the financial security of the PhD student, the main supervisor needs to show all the money ready for the 4 years payment in his or her account at the beginning of the PhD to even make the PhD position available. That's quite a lot of money. However, most research grants are 3 years, which makes it hard to fund a full PhD. But once a PhD position is established, it has to be advertised by law, so you will find this information online. There are many nice universities in Sweden, and I have summarized their website to the best of my knowledge in the description if you're interested. I also recommend this Study in Sweden website. They have information about all sorts of study in Sweden. I did my master here in Sweden, by the way, and I used this website extensively when I was applying. Who can apply? Since it is a job, so the requirement can be position specific. but a master degree in the relevant field is a must. A cover letter to state the motivation and the CV are also required. The CV has to include information about education, work experience, publication, language, and contact information of two reference people, that's someone that knows you well professionally. There was also a language requirement, as the PhD education is in English, and I am an international student from China, which is not an English-speaking country. I thought I needed to retake an English proficiency test like TOEFL, because my previous test result expired years ago. But luckily, my master education was in English, and it was enough to prove that I can speak English. After the eligibility assessment, there are interviews to assess the ability and suitability. How this is depends a lot on the supervisors, HR of the department, and of course the research project itself. I will ask around for my PhD friends for their experience in order to give you a more comprehensive view about this. Give me a thumb up or the comment below if you're interested. If you nailed the interview and finished some administrative paperwork, congratulations, you're officially a PhD student. There is one more educational milestone of starting a PhD, which is within 1 month of admission, an ISP needs to be drafted. It stands for Individual Study Plan, which is a plan of how you will work with your supervisors and a blueprint of your research work, publications, courses you're going to take, and other activities like teaching or study visits. An ISP needs to be presented and defended at an ISP seminar, which should be planned within the first 3 months of enrollment. This ISP seminar could be Karolinska specific, as I know that this one does not exist in some other Swedish universities. This is an opportunity for an external viewer to give comments on the PhD project and for the student to have a practice with the opponent. It is not an examination, so the student cannot fail this ISP seminar and get kicked out of the doctoral program. What's written in the ISP will be followed up and updated yearly. By the end of the second year of the PhD, there is another defense called half-time seminar. If a PhD student do not wish to continue in academia, he or she can stop here and get a licentiate degree. Of course, if continued, by the end of the 4 years, there should be a thesis defense to obtain a PhD title. Hope I managed to provide some useful information about starting a PhD in Sweden. I will not be a full-time PhD as I am continuing my current job, so my PhD is actually going to be 5 years. It's gonna be a long challenge and hopefully an interesting one. I'll share what I've learned and the ups and downs of this journey on my channel. Stay tuned if you're interested. Thank you so much for watching. Hope to see you in the next challenge.